And hello, everyone. We are here for episode 6 of Gamer Stories. I'm so excited. I'm Trooper SJP, which you know. And I am very excited to have as a guest the amazing RocketteFox, who I know because she was a player in the Night Witches campaign that I GM'd. She's an amazing artist, and her artwork is, I need to point to it properly.
It looks like you're about to do it looks like we're about to like Dragon Ball Z together.
Yes, it's right over here.
I don't know which way I need to go because of the camera and which way we're facing, but I think I'm doing it the wrong way. Hang on. I'm trying to look at the Twitch stream and it's a hair behind. Right. So if we can just, wait. Hang on. Okay. Stay there. Hang on. We're about to catch up.
Yeah.
I think we're about to be there.
Right.
Wait.
I'm there.
I think we made it. Yes. Yeah. We're doing it. We're about to turn into one person.
Yes. Amazing artist, great gamer, and also the president of the board of an amazing nonprofit out in St. Louis. So give us your intro, and then I'm going to ask you a lot of questions.
Yes. So I am RocketteFox. The first part of my intro is that I am super thrilled to be here. I love talking to people, and I love talking Trooper specifically. So this is awesome. I am an illustrator, performer, gamer, storyteller. Just get my hands into all sorts of crazy things.
Also a board gamer too.
I am. I do a lot of board gaming and video gaming, all sorts of stuff. But yeah, no, I saw a couple things just popping up on the chat over here that I wanted to speak to as well. These headphones are Accent Wear. They were kickstarted, I think, a while back.
Oh.
They were bought by Brookstone. But they were there for a minute, so now they're on my head. but also somebody was commenting on my makeup.
Oh.
And I wanted to say thank you so much. I actually, a little shameless self-plug here. One of my side projects that I do is I have an Instagram that is at Makeup and Mice, and it's where I do interesting different makeup looks almost every day with my rats. And in that, I do not do makeup looks on the rats. They just hang out with me while I take the photos.
Type that into the chat? And by the way, chat, feel free to ask questions. We're all looking at chat with you, so you can ask us all of the things. But your makeup looks are so amazing. I have always been so impressed. You know, I just think makeup is hard, and to do it well, like, takes all of the skill and practice. So I'm always very, very impressed.
Thank you. Well, and you know, it's surprisingly enough, if you do something every day, one tends to get better at it. Whoa, how about that?
What?
A little truth bomb there.
Did you ever watch the reality show Face Off on Sci-Fi?
I am aware of it. I did not watch. I didn't have Sci-Fi, I think, at the time when it was running, so.
So for those of you in chat who don't know, it's a reality show where people have to do sort of sci-fi makeup, where it's a competition where they're like saying, you know, go and create some kind of werewolf creature, right? And they've got like 3 days to design the werewolf, and then they like do the clay sculpture of the werewolf, and they make a mold, and they make all the pieces.
Yeah, like all the silicon work and
right,
stuff.
All that work, and they put it on the people, and then they do the makeup and spray it and all that stuff, and they're props. They're really amazing. But here's the thing, which is really interesting, that there's like when you watch a reality show that's about people who are really talented and they're all really good at all the things, and there's like that one thing that you ask them to do and then they're all surprisingly really bad at it. In Project Runway, it's making pants. Like, apparently they just can't make men's clothing and they just fall apart.
To be fair, pants seem like they would be a very complicated thing to do.
Yeah. What they can't do, and not all of them can't do it, but quite a few of them can't do beauty makeup on Sci-Fi's Face Off. So it's interesting, right? So if they're made to, like, if they do like a mermaid or something that is not like a zombie, they're like half the contestants are like, we don't know how to do eye makeup. What? And I was like, you can make somebody look like they're 100 years old. You can't do some eye makeup. Come on.
I will tell you though, it's actually there is something to it though, and especially, you know, as an Asian person.
Yeah.
You know, it's because it got to the point where I ran out of my own ideas, so I started like flipping through Pinterest trying to see what the kids were doing these days, just to get some more inspiration. And you know, a simple anatomy lesson. The way my eyelids fold is not the same as the way that a lot of other non-Asian eyelids fold. So I can't do the same kind of eye makeup because my eyes don't function in that way. So it becomes a whole different type of, you know, I have to make, you know, you'll notice my eyeliner is very thick because when I open my eye, it disappears. It's like a magic trick. you know, and these are all things.
and it's interesting because I was talking to DSB, who's one of the community members, and she was also talking about Asian eyes and eye makeup, and that if you have to get on the right Tumblrs and Pinterest to be able to get eye makeup ideas, because all the stuff you're going to be normally seeing is just not at all geared toward your eyelids. And it was really interesting. And I was like, oh, and Levi, you're actually right. And Sal says, like, 90% of people on Face Off only ever did, like, horror movie monsters, and that was their comfort zone. And I think it's actually, and this is right, this is true, that because they were only doing horror movie monsters and, like, blood effects, they just never had any practice doing beauty makeups. I just feel like, for me personally, I just feel like if you're going to go on a competition reality show, we've got to do a lot of things, you should practice that. Like, if you're going to go on, the cooking ones, like MasterChef, practice desserts, because you know they're going to ask you to do it. Like,
you know you're going to have to at least one. Like, have a dessert in your pocket. Not literally, but you know, have something in there that you're ready for. But, I mean, and it's really interesting. Whenever I've gone on there, there being Pinterest, you know, I mean, there's a lot of, there's actually some really interesting horror-esque things that people are doing with the beauty style makeup too. There's a lot of creativity going on out there in all the different realms, and it's really cool.
That thing you like, I do see your prime. I see your prime crown. I see it. I do see it. Okay, so I need to ask you the opening question.
We got onto a place, but
we'll get back to it. But I need to ask you the opening question. My opening question is, so like, where are you from? Like, just tell me, give me a background of where you're from, and then tell me how you found gaming. But first, where are you from?
In the
larger scheme of things, sure. However, you want to answer that.
I am based out of St. Louis, Missouri, in the Midwest. And that is where I currently live as well.
Central time,
that is correct, which is always very interesting, because the nonprofit we span three different time zones, so whenever I'm trying to make meetings, it becomes an academic endeavor. I'm from there. I am only child. My parents were divorced when I was young, and then they got remarried to each other when I was 18.
What?
They're still married now for some amount of time. it's more than that now, but you know, like, it's
some time even. Period. A number of us in chat, when we were talking before you came on, revealed that we are all not 16.
Whoa. I, for one, am shocked. But I thought all 16-year-olds grew beards like that.
It's true. It's true.
That's how you can tell I'm not 16 yet.
Okay, so tell me how you found gaming.
I was introduced to gaming from a very young age. I was actually, so my father had primary custody of me, which is a little unusual. Mm-hmm. It never really occurred to me that having my own PC growing up and having like all the video game systems, like I was mostly Nintendo girl, I'll be real about that. But you know, I mean, ever since I was young, you know, for Christmas, I got the NES, and then I got the N64, and then, you know, and then eventually moved on to PlayStations and such. But like, I never knew that that wasn't like a girl thing, in those days. Yeah. And not that it's not, but like, you know, just the way that culturally some people considered it.
Yeah.
It just, they, you know, and like my uncle would give me like these Kinect robotic sets and stuff.
Oh,
like
cool.
That. I mean, people were just giving me stuff that looked cool.
Nerd.
Do what?
Because you were a nerd.
Oh, I think it's also because they were nerds.
Because there was like a whole nerd life going on.
A nerd pod. Some of my earliest memories, I remember my dad watching Star Trek Next Generation. And at this point in time, I'm super young and I'm supposed to be asleep, you know, I'm at this point. And I was like, oh, well, I'll just sleep on your lap and I won't be watching. You know, but then we would go like down in the basement, we'd play like Star Trek and I would be the captain.
Nice.
He would be like on my crew. You know, so I mean, it was just kind of like all this stuff coalescing and, you know, so I would do that and play a lot of Mario, a lot of Banjo-Kazooie. Yeah.
What were your games? Which ones did you love?
I played me a lot of some Super Mario World.
Mm-hmm.
I think the ones I played the most, Super Mario World, Super Mario 3, and then my grandparents also had a TI system, which is kind of like an Atari, but not.
Yep.
And so there was a game on there called Hunt the Wumpus.
Yeah.
Which, do you know this one?
I do.
I played that a couple times and it always scared me. It scared me so. I think I was a little too young for that.
Because you don't know where the Wumpus is, right? It's
going. And it plays this scary music. Yeah. This scary, like, I don't even think it was 8-bit. I think we're in like 2 bits of music. Maybe like a half of a bit.
There's
music.
Only a half a bit, but that's it.
It was so scary. Honestly, some of the games, early games I played were some real just like sketch titles. There was like B-52, which I think it where you play literally a bee that is collecting pollen out of these flowers. And I have a dream of being the first person to speedrun this game because I have not been able to find anyone doing it online. And while I'm not a speedrunner, I could really get any time and that would be the record. So I'm wanting to take my show to AGDQ at some point.
I feel like you should do it. I feel like you should do it, and that would be amazing.
You know, like I could be that one person because like I watch a lot of speed running just like while I'm working on my computer, I'll just have it playing, and I'll have it playing over and over, and then you know people will come in and be like, "Are you watching Urban Yeti again?" And I'll be like, "Yes, leave me alone." it could be that next thing.
What is the appeal for speedrunning for you?
I don't know. I was fairly recently introduced to it. but I don't actually watch a lot of just personal individual people doing it. I mostly watch events. And I think a lot of it is because I like the energy of the crowd. I like you know, when there's people commentating on it, like it's the feeling of like experiencing it with a group of people. And everyone's, you know, especially when they're doing like the Kaizo runs and stuff like that. And like everyone's having a really good time and it's really fun. So that's, you know, I'll usually let just like the GDQ just like go on autoplay and just have them go through. And that's honestly how I've been introduced to a lot of games that I haven't played, but look interesting. I'm worried about playing them though, because I feel like I'd approach them and be like, oh yeah, I totally know how this is done. And then, you know, it'll be like, oh, this is way harder than, you know, certain people have made it look.
I know that. So when it comes to speedrunning, my only relationship to speedrunning is, so Morrowind, which I played for like, I don't know, 100 hours, like a long time, right? Cause it's, you know, it's like open world. You can play it forever. That, so epic and all of that. And apparently somebody speed runs it in like 15 minutes. It's this like massive open world RPG, and someone's like, well, once you get off the boat, you can do this thing, go over there, and then like you finish the game. And I was like, but 100 hours, like where did, oh.
Well, honestly, like I prefer to watch like the 100% speed runs. Cause like, come on, man, if you're gonna play the game, you gotta play the, like I've been playing Breath of the Wild since the dawn of time. Like since before time began, before the game was even developed, I've been playing Breath of the Wild. And like, I have not gone into the fourth temple yet because I have been wandering around the wilds, like cutting down trees and collecting ingredients for my food bins and like, you know, all of this stuff. Like, I don't even know. I'm way too into just like looting things for this game.
Rocket.
It's bad. This is why, this was the one thing, like my experience with World of Warcraft, like I had a very special experience. Like I went in there and I had a very curated experience. I had somebody high level take me in there and be like, okay, we're going here. I will take you here. You know, this is the mission. This is what you do. And like,
it's nice.
The looting though.
Yeah.
You know, and Borderlands, the same thing. Like, just there's this one DLC where there's this, you know, a little bit of a glitch you can do to keep looting this armory over and over again. And I will tell you that hours were spent looting this armory. I didn't even need any guns at that point. Like, the game was over. Game is over, and I'm looting these guns just to do it, you know?
Look, I'm not judging you at all, and the reason why is because if there's a game that has inventory and you can get stuff, I'm gonna get all the stuff, and then I'm gonna sit like, oh, I can't hold all the stuff. What do I get rid of? I can't get rid of anything. I need all of the things. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. These are all too special to me. But it's, the thing is too, like, it's, I played Borderlands with my husband, who we have very, he's like a StarCraft player, right? He's a StarCraft kind of guy.
Mm-hmm.
Me, I'm more of, like, you know, well, okay, so we would get in there, right, and, like, you collect the guns, and you can go, and they all have different stats and all this stuff, so you go to the gun vending machines, and I've heard tell of the Stardew Valley, just to make a little note about something. I've not played it yet, but I've heard that maybe I should. But, like, so you go to the gun vending machines, and you can see what the stats are on the guns you've collected and stuff. And this guy is standing there at this gun vending machine for like months straight, like just months looking at this gun while I'm standing there like waiting for him to stop looking at all these stats, because I don't care about stats. I just want to shoot stuff in the face. So I'm like, I have my character and I'm jumping on top of his head and I'm running around. And I'm just like, oh my God, you are literally killing me. In life, I'm literally dying right now if we don't move somewhere.
And also, Levi, I know what you're talking about. I also had the alt accounts that were just standing in the city at the bank. Like, I had, like, my main, my off main, and then, like, two or three others that were just there for the bank. It's true, because I just need the extra, I needed the inventory spaces. I just needed all the inventory. All the inventory. So rough. So tell me when you first got into tabletop role-playing games.
So I actually, the first time I played D&D was with my ex before the person that I am married to now. We've been together for 12 years, so it was sometime before that.
Mm-hmm.
But him and the group of friends, we ended up playing D&D, him and his group, and it was a really good group of people to play with, because I don't know if anybody would catch on to this, but there is only, like, I will take a game, as I would hope came through whenever we were playing Night Witches. Yeah. I will take a game seriously.
Yeah.
But I am also ready to have fun with it.
Yes.
So you know, and this was especially a game that's going to be super open world,
yeah,
you know, where you can go and do anything, you know, and then sometimes you'll play with somebody who wants a very rigid structure, like, no, I want you to go here.
Yeah.
And I'm going to need that from you. And luckily I've generally played with people who are very good DMs.
Yeah.
So we played this, and that was my first experience, and it was great. Like, and people, you know, it was like the kind of thing to where we would get into a fight, and you know, you could do, you know, you would be like, oh, hey, so, you know, I'm going to use my magic power stick to, I don't remember what the characters were at the time or anything, you know, do this. But also, for example, we were riding through the forest one time and we came upon this group of kobolds, and the DM was like, what are you going to do? And I was like, I will befriend these kobolds and take them as my minions.
Nice.
And so I had to roll for that. And anytime I was rolling for something really bizarre, like I happened to do very well. So then for the rest of the game, I just had these kobolds with me. Like, they didn't really like affect anything, but they were just there.
Nice.
They were just there with me. So that really cemented my joy for tabletop role-playing games.
And Krellin, by the way, points out that by classical definitions, Night Witches was a comedy because it ends with marriage as opposed to death, and that is true.
But according to Shakespeare.
Yes, we are, that Night Witches was a comedy, technically.
I mean, to be fair, there were some comedic moments.
There were funny moments. This is fair.
So, you know.
By the way, you were just talking about this first campaign of yours in the kobolds. And you know what occurred to me in my mind?
Go on.
People always like ask, like, why is D&D the number one game? Why D&D, right? And I was thinking about the story you were just telling. And I was thinking, I know everything that you're saying. Right, like, I know what kobolds are, I know what roles you were making, like, I know what that was, and mm-hmm. There's something about Dungeons & Dragons' sort of popularity, whether it's your favorite system or not, that has created a kind of a common language, so somebody who you've never met before, even, can tell you about their character, and they can say, oh yeah, my character had, like, really low wisdom, and you're like, oh, and people...
Right. Well, and even just like, oh, you roll a 20 charisma. Everybody knows what that means, you know?
Yeah, and there's just something kind of interesting about the way that D&D creates a common language for people to sort of bond, even if they've never played together.
Yeah, and like, and don't get me wrong, there, you know, in my older and wiser years, you
sure.
know, I mean, there certainly is more awareness of some of the problematic.
Yeah.
Pieces yeah. to all of this, yeah. you know, and like we, one of the Super Heroines things, they're running a thing in Cincinnati, in the Cincinnati chapter, where there is a group that's currently doing a training on for people who want to learn how to create more purposefully inclusive gaming spaces as DMs. So it's kind of a workshop that people attend, but we created a we have a Heroine's Handbook, which is kind of an ongoing collateral piece, which is, this one is geared toward DMs on just different articles and things on creating more inclusive gaming spaces, which it's a free download that's on the website if anybody wants it. It's like 11 pages or something.
Well, can we rewind for a moment?
Yes.
Because I feel like you've opened it up and now I have to ask you.
Go on.
So tell me about Super Heroines, etc. There's
yes.
this nonprofit. Tell me how you found your way there. Tell me about this. I want to know this story.
Yeah, I'm shifting real quick because my knees are old and creaky.
You have young knees. Maybe you're young. It's just your knees that are not young.
My, you know, they say I have an old spirit. It's actually just my knees. But
wait, somebody, Super Heroines. Got timed out? Somebody posted a link. Sorry about that.
Oh, that looks like that is Carolyn, who is our, Super Heroine CNO. That would be our executive director.
Super Heroine, sorry about that. Nightbot is a little bit tricky. Hello, welcome in. We're going to make
Carolyn,
you.
Yay!
We're going to make you a regular so you can post all the links that you want because we know that you're not a troll. At least you could be a half orc. You know, that's cool.
yes, no, so I'm glad she's here, actually, though. No, so Super Heroines ETC was actually started as a meetup group. She says she's old and doesn't understand the internet's almost as old as my knees. it started actually by Carolyn. Carolyn started the group as a meetup group in order to meet other kind of nerdy women in the St. Louis area at the time. And as things went on, it ended up shifting into a nonprofit. And she actually, like a force of nature, you know, went about and got the nonprofit status, got everything set up, and it kind of went from there.
Was that very complicated?
Yeah, she found the so for people who are wanting to get involved in nonprofit stuff, you can actually work with like universities that have college programs, legal programs. Ooh. A lot of them have like law clinics, and they'll have their students work on stuff for nonprofits sometimes. Like, you have to, you know, submit your stuff.
That's cool.
But yes, the art is by me. I do the art.
Also, this art back there. I mean, you're an amazing artist, but go on. I want to hear more about Super Heroines ETC before I gush about your art for a moment, because we have the time for that.
I actually got involved. The first event I went to was a book swap. And I went and I had met Carolyn and then just got involved on the board, and the rest is history. We've been doing it for some years now. but essentially the mission is to empower women and those who identify as women, and also specifically people who are in communities that have been historically marginalized and such, to embrace their inner nerd. And we do this by events that create safer spaces and give empowering, you know, educational opportunities and such. And we say nerdy, so a lot of it will be geared more toward like gaming, comic books, film, things like that. But really, there's a wide swath there. You know, we've done stuff around film, screenwriting. We'll do stuff that has to do with like history, you know, coding, things like that. So it's a pretty wide arena of things. But it's gotten me involved. And actually, I've since then offshoot branched into the whole storytelling thing, because I initially had gotten involved in that. And doing panels actually through Super Heroines ETC, which I've started to do on my own since then as well. So, I mean, it's given me personally the opportunity to speak nationally at various cons on things like, you know, why diversity and representation in media is important, such as why having Asian characters not played by white people might be something that is a good thing.
Rocket, I feel like you don't want Scarlett Johansson to have all the jobs. And like, what about Scarlett Johansson?
She makes such a good tree that I just, you know, it would be just a shame for
do all the things. It's, you know, first off, I want to know more about the stuff that you've done, because so this GM workshop sounds amazing.
Yeah, and it sounds like it's currently still going, but it sounds like, you know, it's off to a really good start, too. But yeah, the piece that goes with that is the Heroines Handbook on that, which, again, on the website for free download for all the gaming friends.
And it has been linked, and I'm going to have to... Let me copy that link, because I want it. There, just copy the link. Just now I have the link copy.
yes.
Super Heroine CNOE, Carolyn, says some of the GM trainees are already GMing at local game shops. Oh, that is really cool. So do you have like a trainee program?
Yeah, so that's essentially what it is. The people are going through the program to learn different methods. And they're essentially, it was geared toward women, those who identify as women, who want to get into that, who may have felt there's not really opportunities to learn that. So they go in and then practice and have people there to help them and give them guidance and stuff like that, so that they have a space in which they can do that and then go out and then embark into the wild and DM.
I think it's really tricky, right? Because I was thinking about this a lot, about gatekeeping and feeling welcome. And of course, there's always gatekeepers who are saying, oh, you can't get into gaming, or you can't get into comic books or various things, right? But the tricky thing, like comic books, films, you don't necessarily need other people to do those. You can just get them yourself, right? But when you are doing gaming, you need other people. And there's something important about being able to be a GM, not just a player.
Well, and it's, we, you know, another little plug going on. You and I have something that's going to be coming up.
In
the fall.
What?
That's right. We are actually going to be, for this is more for the people, because you already know this.
But, would it be surprising if I didn't know? That'd be funny.
I know. Hey, Trooper.
What?
Surprise. But we're actually doing a panel together at Geek Girl Con in Seattle coming up in the fall, where we are going to be doing a panel on GMing as activism. And that there was one of the article pieces sections in the GMing handbook on the Super Heroines thing. I wrote, actually kind of drew from that thinking process-y as well. And it honestly, it got me thinking too, because the topic of that arena that I was writing on was kind of the idea of deliberately creating a space and what that looks like, you know, because a lot of, what's it called, defaultism, right? Like if something isn't named, then by default, it is what is most common.
Yep.
And while being a cis white male is not necessarily what is most common in our world, it is what perhaps is most common in that sphere of culture. So that is perhaps, you know, and I've had this even happen with myself. If I'm reading a book, I crack it open and like the main character is not, you know, described or named, I might automatically think, oh, it's a white guy, you know, or that is just kind of what automatically happens. And so it causes it to where there aren't these opportunities for, you know, persons of color or different, you know, orientations, backgrounds, whatever, to get involved, to feel welcome. And there, like, there was one part in there that felt a little tricky, I think, you know, because on the one hand too, as a GM, like if you are creating a gaming world that is diverse, you as the GM are going to have to play some roles that are not yourself. And like, and I tried to stress in there too, I was like, this does not mean to go out into the world and pretend that you are a minority person if you are not. Please don't do that. That is not what I'm suggesting. You know, but like, if you don't like
empathy,
right, you know, I mean, but like in an enclosed space, like if you're not creating characters that rep, you know, I, as a biracial Asian woman, like if I am afraid to create any characters that are, you know, black gay men because I'm afraid to portray them, then those characters are never in our games, and then representation isn't there. And then like if anybody comes into play, you know, who might like to see that representation there, it's not there, you know. So it's a very complicated and kind of can be a scary thing to do, but I think it's very important. So
it's also about empathy, like putting yourself in someone else's shoes, I think is important. Can I do you know the joke?
I know a few jokes.
Do you know the joke where there's a doctor and the doctor is at work at the hospital?
Yes, I do know this one.
Right? And the doctor's child, so if you in chat, if you don't know it, and the doctor's child is like a person comes in who's been hit by a car, and the doctor sees this person and says, oh, you know, I can't operate on this person because it's my son. And it was like the doctor and the father, like the person and the father were killed, and people were like, well, how could that be? And of course, the answer is that the doctor is the mother. But so many people never, when you hear there's a doctor who's a surgeon, they don't imagine that could be a woman. And so many people sort of like can't figure out the puzzle of, hey, wild engineer, can't figure out the puzzle of the riddle, because it does not occur to them that the doctor in the riddle could be a woman. And that's the kind of defaultism you're talking about, the ways in which if you just say there's a doctor, people will just like their defaultism will trigger. And another sort of example I thought was super interesting myself was, I don't know if you've heard this, but have you ever heard people
I'm listening,
say, why do Japanese people always draw their anime characters to be white people? Right? That's the thing that I hear often, usually from white people, about like, why do they always just draw all their anime characters to be white people? And I saw this really great video from sort of like a Japanese anime fan saying, we don't.
I know. Well, like, it's so interesting to me, because like, I feel like as an Asian person, I can tell when a character is meant to be a Caucasian person versus when they're not.
Yeah. And they show that, like, if you want to know what white people look in anime, they look like this. And they're like, they don't look at all the same. And it was this really interesting breakdown of what white people look like in anime versus what Japanese people look like in anime, right? And that, right. And was pointing out basically defaultism, right? That because these characters in anime are not what stereotypical Asian people look like in the white imagination, people don't see them as Asian, even though within the context of Japan, they're just seen as Asian. And it was really fascinating to see how defaultism sort of like works, even when you're looking at something created by somebody who's not you. And I thought that was really fascinating. Krellin is saying something.
Yeah, and I saw that too. I wanted to speak to that as well. So Krellin is saying something, having to learn in the role-playing life as a white man, feeling very self-conscious portraying someone who is not a white man, but because of the demographics he has gotten, and of gaming in general, if not portraying white non-men, there often aren't non-white non-men at all. Mm-hmm. And honestly, one of the things that I suggest also is, like, you know, if you are wanting to play, like, you know, a lesbian Asian person, try and find someone with that experience and say, hey, I am wanting to, and explain what you're doing. Yep. You know, be like, hey, so I'm playing this game and I want a character there to represent this. Like, would you mind telling me about how I can do this respectfully? You know? And like, at the end of the day, if they don't want to do it, then respect that and move on. But like, you know, I mean, you know, like, and it could be an opportunity also to be like, you know, and they may be like, oh, well, this is interesting, you know, and maybe you could be like, hey, would you like to come play this or something? Also, I will be right back. I've just drank like so much coffee right now. I have to take a pee break.
Go ahead. I'm going to talk about this thing that came in. First off, anime white people are huge, loud, and have giant noses. Their noses are huge, and they have these like massive jaws if they're men. Often blue up blonde hair. Like once you actually see what white people look like in anime, then it's actually really obvious, right, that there's a difference. It's just a different sort of setting. There was something I was thinking about. Mr. Awful McPherson says, sadly, many historians have written Europeans who look like East Asian people out of its history, even though some predate Indo-European people. Yeah. Oh, Mr. Awful McPherson. Mr. Awful McPherson, why did you just note the thing that makes me crazy? What makes me crazy is the fact that Europe is actually really diverse, historically has always been quite diverse racially. The world is diverse, right? Like, people move from places to places, and that we often write out of history the kind of complexity that that people have had, and that makes me sad because and Mr. Alpenperson says, I'm a Ralik and some have Asiatic features. Right, this is what I mean, right? This is, people move around, and like, there are, the only place that isn't diverse, ironically, is Japan. Although they're the Ainu in Japan. There are sort of indigenous people in Japan. So there is some diversity. They just don't treat the Ainu very well. So that's like a thing. But like, I do feel like the thinking about the sort of the diversity of it is important, to know that diversity has always been there, and sort of thinking about how we can imagine diversity. That's right. In a more complex way. There was something that I wanted to say. You were talking about asking someone Mm-hmm. One of the other things that I think is really important, and this is something I actually think is really important when it comes to portraying other people or interacting with other people in the world, or writing about other people, you know, is if you, because somebody, there was a thread where somebody was talking about this on Twitter that was talking about an RPG that was doing a lot of Orientalist kind of creepiness. And the person was saying, hey, don't portray people in this Orientalist gross way. And somebody asked, well, how in the world do you do that? Like, how do you portray other people and not have it be gross? And I was like, ooh, wow. I understand that that's a sincere question, but the fact that you cannot imagine how to portray other people without it being gross makes me a little worried. Right. And my response is always, do you ever read books written by people that you're talking about, or listen to music by people that you're talking about, or like, sometimes you don't even have to actually ask them in person, but do you ever consume media written by women or by people of color? Because you need to listen to them, right? Like, you need to be able to see them as people and not as a fantasy. And the best way to do that is by actually consuming things written and produced by them. And that is so important. I think that it's like, you know those guys, I was in the army with those guys who are like, women, who knows what they think? And I was like, you know, there are ways to find out what women are thinking. It's not that hard.
What a mystery. Who possibly could know such things?
I don't know. How do we find it out? If he says, I think something Rocket was saying earlier is that the GM and players creating this world is ultimately in a small setting, so the form and platform in which to play out non-self roles is kind of small testing ground for players and the GM, and you need some permission to self to maybe not always get it right. Oh, totally. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's different. Like, it's different doing something in a setting like that than, like, I am donning your culture as a costume.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
To amuse myself. You mm-hmm. know, I mean, it's, you know, like, it's... Look, like, just don't, you know, it's like wearing Native American headdresses at a music festival. Just don't do it. It's not, don't, just don't.
I think it comes down to, really, do you see these people as people? And weirdly, maybe not weirdly, it's so obvious to me that often people don't. Like, they don't see women as people. The minute you say, I have no, like, if somebody says to me, and this is a complicated thing, right? If somebody says, because, and it's complicated because I know people who have portrayed women really poorly, and I was like, ooh, time out, no. But when someone says, like, I don't think I could ever, like, if I hear a guy say, I don't think I could ever play a woman in RPG, because I would have no idea how to play a woman at all. Like, I mean, I have no idea. I was like, women are people. Like, they are people.
It's not really that hard.
Right, like... I mean, sure, women have different experiences, and of course, intersectionally, not all women have the same experience, but, right. Like, women are people. Like, if you can play a person, you should be able to play a woman as long as you understand that women are people, right?
And well, I think that... Also, and the thing is, too, it's like, you know, it's like, whenever I was going through editing this thing, too, one of the things came to my mind, what you had said before as well, is, you know, when you were doing research on the Night Witches thing and you would watch this one thing and somebody was like, well, my character, it has a huge rack, you
yeah,
know,
and all this yeah. stuff. And it's
like, you know, and I'm thinking about that. It's like, oh, how would a woman behave? Oh, no, I can't reach this. My huge boobs are in the way, you know, because that's something we deal with all the time. Like, I mean, look, some people do deal with that kind of thing, but that's not how it's going down. Like, you know.
And I'm going to say that if you have a huge rack, you know, there might be things like back pain involved, really.
It's guaranteed, just not like, oh, I'm just going to, but, you know, like, you know, they're just flying around, you know.
No, like, there's me a sports bra, just sports bra right there.
You know, like, it's, but, like, you know, and it's, at the end of the day, and I feel like this goes with a lot of comedy and stuff, too, as well as portrayals and things like that. Like, you know, yes, a person from that group can make jokes about things yeah. within that group that a person not from that group cannot, because there's a difference between, you know, making fun of and acknowledging something and laughing together, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, you know, going back to the whole Native American headdress thing, like, it's, you know, it's the sort of situation to where this is a group of people that literally were killed for their culture, that literally had their children stolen to erase the culture from them, like put into schools. And then white people can just wear this stuff around like ornaments? Like, that's pretty tacky.
Yeah.
And tacky does not even begin to describe it, but like, it's real gross if like tacky like were multiplied on the gross factor by like 10,000, you know, like.
And I think also there's a just, you know, those people who are going to get their kanji and then they don't even know what it means. And you're like, maybe don't do that. Like, don't get the tattoo of like, of the, like, what are you doing? Like, people are not ornaments, right? People are not ornaments. And
well, and also like you, like it's a kind of thing. Like if you, I will say this, like I went to, like, if you look, if you're a speaker, you know, and you like, I went to, there was this, there's an Asian association in St. Louis, so I went to one of the barbecues there, and there was this guy in front of me, and I'm biracial, so I, you know, I understand, I am half white, I've, you know, seen a white person or two in my day.
Me
so,
too!
Like, you know, there's, like, there's this white guy in front of me, and he, as, you know, and he's standing there, he's talking to me for a second, he's a little bit older, and he was married to one of the gals there, he's also the secretary of the Asian Association, and is so fluent in like, I don't forget which brand of Chinese, but so fluent. And I was like, sir, you are like 10,000 times more Chinese than I am. Well, I'm not Chinese, but like you are 100 times more Asian than me. Like this, you know, cool on you. But like culturally I am, it's, you know, but.
And it's fine, right? There's, I mean, by the way, all of y'all in chat are saying such interesting things. And this idea that people are like, oh, I could never play an X, but then they're playing, you know, a troll or a null, right? And you're like, what? And Arissa says this thing I think is so smart, which is that great sort of the balance, right? That it applies to gender, race, or a lot of other categorizations we apply to people. Knowing the culture or history or experience of a group of people is important, but people are fundamentally people. And right, so there's this thing where you have to know that people have different experiences, but they're also still people. And like just sort of rolling that in. And a Mr. Alphamic person is talking about how Norwegian, Swedish, and Icelandic, Danish folk musicians use shamanic drums, which were used by the Sami, whose culture and themselves were systematically murdered, right? And this is, and like, and of course, I think it's so important to think about this, the ways in which we also do this to ourselves, right? That we will sort of like self-mythologize in ways that are often erasing people like the Sami or indigenous people, like thinking about those things. And I mean, for me, I was just thinking about this because, you know, I was thinking about our panel just the other day, Rocket. I was thinking about it.
It's going to be awesome, by the way.
So
if anyone is going to find themselves in the Pacific Northwest around the time of specifically November, I think 16th and 17th, it's going to be then, and it's going to be fantastic. So,
it's so good.
It's a great con too. Like it's very cool. So continue.
So one of the things I was thinking about was, like, what makes activism as a GM? Like, right, what does that mean? What does it mean to do that? And one of the things that I was thinking about was, it's about being deliberate about the experience. Right, let's say you're like a GM who's not thinking about it at all. You're just like, I'm gonna make a game. And you just make the game. But I think that if you're going to do it as activism, it's about thinking not only like, ooh, I hope I can make a good game. I want to make sure they're like good puzzles and whatever. But thinking, what do I want? How do I want my players to have changed at the end of this campaign? Right? What is the takeaway that I want? Do I want them, for example, and this, okay, so for example, like, let's say you have a group of all men, perhaps. Like, because like, it's great if you have a diverse player base. And I think if you're streaming, you really need to, like, just do that. Like, don't not do it because now you're streaming. But maybe you're just doing a little group at your home and your group is all not particularly diverse. But then I think as a GM, you should think about, okay, I know this is not a very diverse group. What small thing do I want them to get by the end of this one campaign? And maybe that thing is you want them to sort of think about female NPCs in a more rich way. And so you are going to build that in deliberately into that campaign so that by the end of that, that's going to happen. Or maybe you want them to really think about power and violence a little bit more in a nuanced way, right? And so you decide that you're going to build that into the campaign. And I just think that the activism part is partly about just really thinking, yeah, as Javai says, plan for more than just the immediate and short-term enjoyment of the group. Try to think about, like, what, like, how do I want the world to be a better place? How do I want this gaming group, this one little group, to be a better group at the end of this, you know, 5-6 months than it was at the beginning? And I think that's part of it, is a real deliberateness about thinking about what you're doing and knowing if there are things that you can learn. And it could also be for you as a GM, like, how do I want to be better at the end of those 6 months as well?
Yeah, and I think also, like, you know, even having the world that you create have just more representation in it, right?
Yeah.
Like, make the world look diverse. Make your characters reflect that, you know? Like Mr. Alpha McPherson says. Mm-hmm. Great name, by the way. You know, but make your characters reflect that. Like, especially if you're playing with a group that is, you know, if you're playing with a group that's primarily male, primarily white, you know, put them in a situation where they're in a world that's primarily different than that, mm-hmm. you know, so just to have, and even if that's the one thing you do, like, that's a valuable experience to have, is feeling enriched in a different type of space, you know, that's, and even like, look, if you're in some sort of fantasy space, like, none of that should reflect modern day white culture anyway. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because that's not what that would look like, but, you know, I mean, it's very easy just to fall back on that kind of thing.
And then Javai says, and if he says, like, even just women in different roles of power, and Javai says, diverse worlds and settings are much more interesting anyway. We have enough Northwestern European fantasy worlds and fantasy as it is. Super Heroine mm-hmm. says, I really love the Good Society game because it encourages participants to reconsider the gender dynamic of Jane Austen's time. And one of the mm-hmm. options is to totally flip the gender power dynamic. I totally agree. Can I just call you Carolyn? Is that okay? Or I'll call you Super Heroine Sino. one thing I think is also interesting about this, especially in complicated sort of historical spaces, mm-hmm. is, hey, ALBGS2, I think I promised to come to your stream when you did a special, but I couldn't because I had to leave learn for my exams. Exams. Yes, welcome.
Those exams.
Yeah, welcome in. I was thinking about so here's one of the things about the past I think is really tricky, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of our understanding of the past is fiction, right? Like, it's not real. It's not actually how it was at all. Mm-hmm. And we do things like, oh, well, you know, women just stayed at home and didn't do anything. And I was like, that's just not true. If you were a farmer, women were farming, right? Like, if you were a peasant, women were just working, because all peasants were working, so none of that was true.
That, yes.
Like, I mean, and a lot of our, like, oh, the medieval time period, like, most of our ideas, that, like, most of the popular ideas of the medieval time period are just, like, actual fictions written by Renaissance writers, right? And then it's just not true. So, like...
Well, and also, and the thing, too, is, like, it depends on where you look, because if you look at, like, you know, historical... Korean culture, for example, like, whenever the Japanese took over Korea, women were, like, assassinating and fighting people because everybody was doing that, you know. But it's, you know, but it's the same, in the same
C-Alb,
way, you know.
C-Alb, GS2. Enjoy your exams.
Or at least kick them in the butt. You know, but, like, I've seen people post about this a frequent amount as of late, too, but, like, the idea of, like, making America great again, that whole idea, you know, but, like, people talking about, oh, you know, like, how great things were in, like, the 50s and 60s, you know, and it's like, great for who, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, but the idea being that, like, even for the white suburban communities, like, the idea of nostalgia is not drawn from actual true facts, is drawn from the feelings of how things were,
and
how things actually were
for
that select demographic of people, and not all the other people who were being shat on everywhere.
Yeah, and what's so interesting, like, so, like, there's a film, this is not a good film, but I recommend it. Well, it's not a bad film, but it's not, you know what I mean?
I like bad films, so, you know.
Like, I would say, it's not like it's called Date Bait. DateBait, Date Bait.
It's okay.
It's a 1950s, but I think it's actually early 60s teensploitation film. So it's one of these films that was aimed at teenagers that they go to the drive-in and watch. So it's like a very low, very low budget film. They did not spend a lot of money on the writing and all that business. Sort of aimed at teenagers. And it's early 60s, late 50s. And what's interesting about it was that we imagine the 50s as this way where everything is great and everything is cool and like blah, 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 right? And we imagine particular kind of gender roles, right? How men are and women are and all this. Probably because we watched, I don't know, Leave It to Beaver or something. And this was a, not a mainstream, main movie theater film, main studio film, and it was aimed at teenagers rather than their parents. And it starts off, and I remember when I saw the first scene, I was like, oh, well, this is interesting. So there's like a two couples at this, like a diner maybe, but you get the sense the diner is like outside of the suburb a little bit, so you drive off to it.
So, oh, yeah.
Yeah, so it's like a slightly divey, but not exactly. And they're out there dancing, and then this guy shows up, and when he shows up, Brad, everyone's like, oh, Brad's back, where's he been? Oh, he's back. Oh, and like, clearly there's some kind of scandal about it. And he walks up to the main couple, the lead couple, and he's like, hey, Janie, let's dance. And she's like, I don't want to dance with you, Brad. And then Brad turns to the guy that she's dancing with, and he says, you know, oh, real great, like I go away and you steal my girl. And she turns to him and she says, but you're wrong, Brad, in that way, because she's not the best actor. I'm not your girl, fair. Right? Like, and I never was your girl, and I don't want to dance with you. And what was interesting is that she has a lot more agency than we imagine girls had in the 1950s.
Right.
And he was in rehab for heroin, by the way. So, like, clearly it was not great for everyone.
Right.
So.
Brad.
And then he pulls out a knife. There's like
come
a.
Come on to my house, my house.
Oh, no.
Come on. We have a dance party.
Come on to my house, my house. I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you everything.
Ooh, thank you for the host, Crit Witch. And at 1960, thank you, Falcon O'Bannon. And so, like, here's this thing, like, in this night, this, like, pure 1960s or 1950s we're thinking of, like, oh, there were heroin problems. And this girl was, like, her parents were like, you know, hey, Janie, we see you're dating this guy, but we think you should be dating lots of guys, not just one guy. We're kind of concerned about the fact you're only dating one guy. And, like this sort of the way
that... Interesting.
Right, like, that's not how we portray the 50s at all. And so sometimes you can see...
Right.
That actually... there were no drugs till Woodstock and hippies, though. And I was just thinking about the ways in which you could do Jane Austen, Good Society, because you know it's more complicated than the way we do it in movies, right? Like, you know that there were women at this time period who were like, well, how can I maneuver within this framework that I have? Or people who had a lot of money could do whatever they wanted, right? And just sort of thinking about the ways in which you know the history is more complicated because there were people there, right? And people are able to push back. Oh, don't worry about that, Critch. Welcome in.
Well, and like, it's, and the thing too, like, it's, you know, there are various instances of women who dress like soldiers to go to war. You know, I mean, even, you know, it's, even if it's not something that was being done by everyone. Everybody, like, people everywhere were getting into some stuff.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
You know, everywhere were doing something that was a little scandalous and whatnot. Like, one of my favorite historical figures is La Maupin. Have you?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Ah, La Maupin, the woman who I aspire to be when I grow up, even though she died when she was, like, 32. But she, to be fair, she lived the life as if she had lived many, many, many more years than that. But like,
yes.
She, for anyone who was unfamiliar, she was, I think it was in the 1600s, France. She, you know, and there, look, 1600 France, court life at the time, like she, her father was like a teacher or a tutor or someone near the court. So she was by that, but she wasn't like a noble herself. And there was a duke or somebody who took her as his wife while she was incredibly young. So that was a little weird. But she, you know, she grew up with the page boys and stuff. So she learned to ride and sword fight and stuff. And so she essentially, like, slept around a bunch and, like, went and did her thing. And she, like, traveled the road with her. She had a guy who was teaching her sword fighting that she took as a lover. So she ran off with him and started doing these sword exhibitions, and she dressed like a man, and like she there was one time when she broke, so she took on this lady lover, and the lady's parents put the lady into a nunnery, And so she went and she broke the gal out of the nunnery by lighting the nunnery on fire and leaving like a dead body there in this gal's place.
As you do.
As one does. You know, but then like one time she went to a ball and was challenged to a duel by three different men, you know, because she like had made out with this gal or something. You know, I mean, she did all this wild stuff, you know, and she beat all three of these men in the duel.
Of course she did.
You know, but like she was an opera singer and a performer, yeah. And she just did her own biz. Like, if someone like that was chilling in the 1600s, like, please.
Right.
Please.
And we've got like Fa Mulan, Boadicea, Tamar the Great. I mean, Mary Read. We have amazing people in here. And I think it's just one of those things where even if you don't, and I think it becomes really interesting to think about, even not in that big expansive way, there are still like small ways that people are able to make resistance. Like this girl in this movie Date Bait, she wasn't like a greaser or anything with like a leather jacket, but she's just like, no, Brad, I don't want to date you and I don't want to go out with you and I'm not interested in you and like you don't own me. And like there are so many different ways to, and I think that that's the thing, that when you're playing a character in an RPG, you're playing a person, right? And people have wants and desires and needs, and they will find ways to survive and thrive, you know, or struggle, and to allow people to do that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Which also, like, I feel like I just need to issue a no Brad challenge. Like, find opportunities in your life just to say, no, Brad, I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
I was never your girl.
Yes.
You know, yes. Bonus points if you actually say this to someone named Brad. I'm just throwing it out there.
And I that line is still in my head because it was just so perfect. And it was just one of these things where like, no, that's not how, like all the stories we've told, they're not true. And I, that's not how it was. And I like it. Like I like to know it. Right. I.
Yep.
And I was thinking about this.
Design a no Brad.
No Brad. Like, yes, please do.
Like, it's just it is the most obscure thing that I have always loved. I never knew that I've always loved.
You must. It is so good. And of course they're like car chases because it's a movie for teens, right?
Right.
So like there are car chases, there's heroin, there's trouble, but they all get it. they work it out in the end.
There's trouble.
There's trouble, because, and of course, it's so fascinating to me because this movie, like, everybody in the movie is white.
Ish?
Let's say everybody presents as white. Let's just say that.
Okay.
I have some questions, like, Brad and his uncle, I feel like, are supposed to be Italian mobsters, but it's a little unclear. It's a little unclear.
Okay.
But the movie wasn't, this movie... And there are a lot of these sort of like exploitation movies that were not made for mainstream audiences. They were made for very specific audiences, teenagers, people of color, whomever is looking for it. And because they're not trying to go for the full whole audience, you get these other stories. And this goes back to representation and diversity, right? Mm-hmm. Being able to find these movies, these trashy movies aimed at teenagers, means we're getting different stories about the 1950s than we would have gotten if we only looked at mainstream television. And... Mm-hmm. By seeing these movies, we get to see that the 1950s were more complicated than the stories were told, and that's so valuable. Like, I feel pretty excited about that. And Krellin says, I thought Italians were officially white. Legally white, yes, but socially, it's a little bit tricky. The crossover really of Italians coming into whiteness starts happening in the 1950s.
Well, so, they weren't always legally considered white either, correct?
I don't believe so. Well, in the U.S.
Like, initially, there was a line.
Yeah. So, like, so a lot of the white ethnics were not exactly white, and then they sort of become white, and it's...
Well, I think also, like, the Irish, too.
Yeah, the Irish, too. As a matter of fact, random fun fact, in the 1950s, Irish were white in the 50s. By the 1950s, Irish were white. They hit whiteness probably in the 19-teens and 1920s is when the Irish probably became about white, when they got sort of solidified in whiteness. But the other groups didn't really hit their whiteness until a little bit later.
Isn't it weird that it's hitting whiteness, though?
Yeah.
I mean, like, Yeah, and I know that Carolyn's had, like, her family was Italian.
Yeah.
I mean, they still are, but, like, you know, but, like, there's those experiences there. But, like, isn't it interesting? It's, like, the envelopment of whiteness, and that made the, like, that actually made me think, too. It's, like, you know, Asians are a model minority, but it's, like, if we become, like, totally normalized, will we become white as well? Will then soon Latino people become white? Will Black people too then become white? Will we all become white? Is that the pocket of acceptance of becoming white?
That's the question. And Krillin's pointing out about a lot of, and this is an important point, a lot of the non-whites were not Protestant. A lot of the white ethnics, what made them ethnic was that they were not Protestant. Like, that's like, so the classic white ethnics are Irish, Polish, Greek, Italian, Slavs.
Interesting.
Yeah, and Jews, right? So, like, those are your they call them white ethnics. And Super Heroines, like, as Italians, were very often portrayed as mobsters, even nowadays. Oh, yeah. And actually, Super Heroines, you know, sort of in the 1920s, 30s in the South, when all the lynching was happening, the group after Black people that were lynched the most were Italians in the South.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's, and so thinking about like weirdness about racial categories, one of the things I thought was, I think this is really fascinating. Why? Because, you know, my mind. And yeah, Carl's like, it's almost like white is a wholly constructed thing with no actual meaning. Like,
whoa, you mean no one is actually this color?
Like, what? Oh. Yeah.
That's so crazy.
You're not, Dumber Boy says, you're not white, you're as white as Jesus himself. Wait, what? He was Jewish? What? Well, I never.
I know. I feel like there are people out there literally shitting themselves when it's like, you do know that Jesus was Middle Eastern. Like,
right? He's from the Middle East, right? No? What?
I don't know how to break this to you. He was, in fact, a brown person. Like,
so this, I think, is, this trips my mind. I love these things because it's like, how weird are we? Somebody's watching me, and I have no privacy. Whoa, I always feel that somebody's watching me. Tell me, is it just a dream? Thank you so much for the follow, Abeluk. We already have hit over 500, so we're gonna do a Pig Latin stream sometime in the very near future. Welcome in. So good. Javai says, race identity, gender identity, and other similar things historically were very different than how we view them today. People just assume common sense has been the same since the start of time, and identities haven't changed. And that is so true. So one thing I think is so interesting is that in South Africa, during the time of apartheid, people were legally categorized as either white, black, or colored. That's only three categories.
Interesting. Two people who do not know better colored, one would have thought would fit into one of those categories because of how it was categorized here in older times.
Yep. No, we had a nice, I actually don't think Rocket can hear the alert, so I think she just sees.
I cannot. I honestly, it's just spontaneous acapella. So
I just,
it's delightful though. Like, it's a delightful surprise. So that's nice.
So here's the thing, right? Because apartheid, you could only live in the spaces that were according to your race. So here's interesting stuff. Two things. Chinese people were black, and I believe that Japanese people were colored or white. In the categorization, and that has to do with, like, Chinese people being communist, like China being a communist country, and so them not liking them, so then putting them racially in the black category. But,
you know,
like, how random is this? And then, so interesting, if a white person married a black person, which you're not allowed to do, but let's say you did, that white person would be recategorized racially as black because they would then have to live in the black area, right? So, like, so you'd have in the newspaper, like, so-and-so is now black. And you're just like, okay, South Africa, you're...
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. We've got a subscription. Excuse me.
Come on, everybody. I said, now let's play a game. I bet you I can make a rhyme out of anybody's name. The first letter of the name. I treat it like it wasn't there. And then a B or an F or an M will appear. And then I say bo at a b, then I say the name, then banana fan of info. And then I say the name again with an F, very plain, then a fee, fi and a mo. And then I say the name again with an M this time, and there isn't any name that I can rhyme.
Vopez, 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 Bobopez, banana, fana, fofopez, fifa, momopez. Vopez. Thank you, Vopez, for the spontaneous singing. Krillin says, Trevor Noah speaks about that sometimes, about how his mother was his father's housekeeper so they could live in the white places. Right, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Critwitch, you're getting the Critwitch notes that RocketteFox is getting the full academic foxhole experience, and
this is great, because like I actually so full disclosure, I have not been on the Twitch as often as I should. I'm actually, my plan is to actually get a regular schedule back on again. I know. Even I too am shocked. But I got back on here, and I think right after we had finished with Night Witches, someone had whispered at me, being like, "Oh, when this was in May," and somebody was like, "Oh, when are you normally streaming?" And now, about 3 months later, I'm going to be like, "Not that often, I guess."
Rocket, somebody just gave bits, and so you get so, and they gave bits specifically so you could get the full discography.
All right, I'm ready.
So, when we get bits or tips here, I sing We're in the Money, as sung by Ginger Rogers in the film Gold Diggers of 1933, which is in Pig Latin. And so, I want to thank you, Drummer Boy, for those bits. It is much appreciated, and for you. Earway and hay, the anime. Earway and hay, the anime. Eve at gale out way of way at way exte ute at gale young way. Earway and hay, the anime. Eve I skays are ani say. Old may andy eighty ash and pray. Ooh yare ooh, trevi uste unwe young rayo. Ewe evne eedway edle ainsley. Of wed brayainsley ute day. And when we see the endly or we'll look at the eye get ray in the eye. We're in the money. We're in the money. We've got a lot of what it takes to get along.
I don't even know. I don't even know the process it would take to for like a year. Okay. But I'm just like, how on earth?
I have been practicing.
Oh, the name game. Come on, everybody. I said, now let's play a game. I bet you I can make a rhyme out of anybody's name. The first letter of the name, I treat it like it wasn't there. And then a B or an F or an M will appear. And then I say bo at a B, then I say the name, then banana, fan, or info. And then I say the name again with an F, very plain, then a fee, fi, and a mo. And then I say the name again with an M this time, and there isn't any name that I can rhyme.
Abalek, 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 Bo Babalek, Banana Fana, Bo Babalek, Fee Fi Mo Mabalek.
Come on to my house, my house, come on.
Amazing.
Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you everything.
Thank you for the host. Oh my goodness.
Oh man, you're getting the full, yeah, the full gamut. And by you, I mean me. It's me. I'm getting all of it.
So excited. So are you going to go, and I just need to know, are you going to go and start streaming? Because you should.
Come out of my house, my house, I'm gonna give you candy. Come out of my house, I'm gonna give you everything.
By the way, I love that song because it's creepy.
Like a hand mouth.
Like, yeah.
Oh man, but like, yeah, no, I was before a little bit when I was playing League of Legends for regular.
Ooh.
But I haven't played in a little bit, and the meta has changed so much that I feel like I'm gonna suck so much more. But honestly, like, I don't. So my biggest thing has just been like, what should I?
Come on to my house, my house. Come on to come on to my house, my house.
But I've actually seen that like.
Come on to my house, my house. I'm gonna give you candy. Come on to my house, of my house. I'm gonna give you everything.
And also, I've seen some extreme storytelling too, which. That would be right up my alley, so.
Oh, you know what some people do? Iffy has done this, although Iffy has not done it recently, Iffy. Iffy has just streamed him drawing.
Okay, yeah, and that's what I've heard. So that could be, I've been doing a lot more of that recently for my upcoming project.
Stream art, thank you, Krellen. So tell me about your art. Tell me about this.
Yes, I am an artiste. So here, let me flip on another light. It's getting dark up here in the Midwest. I guess the best place I have been doing art, as most artists would say, my entire life. But I think that the best way to describe it would be, I have a couple things here I can show you.
Yes!
They're literally always right here, because I haven't found a home for them yet. I can go ahead and tell you about my upcoming project that I'm going to be releasing.
Ooh!
So I had mentioned this to you actually before.
Yes.
But my hopes and dreams were to release this on my birthday, which is in 2 days. We'll see if that becomes a dream or if I will actually hold off on that. But I am doing my first very own personal project coloring book, which is going to be called Folked Up. It is going to be a punsational bestiary.
Oh.
It is going to be a 20 pun folktale creatures. So what we have here, and I can actually show you the creature that is one of the creatures that was the original, but one of the, let's see, where are you? There we go. So one of the ones that is going to be in the book, this is the initial drawing I did that was for like, you know, they have the 30 days, draw something every day kind of thing. And one of the months was folklore and fairy tales. So I ended up doing the hippocamp, which is a half horse, half fish, but it's very hip, you see?
Oh yeah.
See how hip it is?
it's got the little glasses. It's got a nice.
Got the glasses, we got the man bun up here, or lady bun.
Right.
I sport that as a ponytail right now, but we got the satchel.
Oh yeah.
Tattoos. We got the scarf.
Oh yeah, that scarf is super hip.
So there's going to be a coloring book version of this that I redid.
Oh.
And then another one, which makes an appearance in the book, is, let's see if I can. Oh yes, one of my personal favorites.
Krellen points out that Hippocampus was combining horses with fish before it was cool.
That's true. That's true. we also have here. The gentle manticore.
Oh, nice!
Gentle man.
I love it. I love it.
So.
I appreciate the facial hair of that gentle manticore. I just want you to know it.
This will be, and so the ones that are going to be in the book are actually a little bit more of a more of my cartoon style, which is, so my two styles are essentially kind of like that, and the other one is kind of like this.
Oh, that's so cool.
Thanks. So the coloring book is some sort of middle ground between these two things. So that's what I'm currently working on. And when I am finished, I am going to actually do an indie. I can't put this away. It lives here forever now. I'm going to be doing an Indiegogo. And so the essentially what is going to happen is that the different levels, and I had a friend help me come up with this for me, marketing things for myself is very confusing, but there's going to be at the first level, there's going to be stickers and a print, And then if you do the full book level, there will be the full book and stickers, and there's going to be all sorts of fun things going on. So,
Rockette.
That's me.
I'm wondering if you might do me a favor.
I am known for my favor doings.
When the Indiegogo comes out, will you put the link all over everywhere and give it to me so I can put it on my Discord and all of the places? Like, I want to put it in the Geekspace TV one, like all the places, because you know people love puns. And
yes, I would love that. No, I just to give, like, just so everyone knows, this is the first place y'all here are getting the first look at some of the internal pieces going on. So just so you know what there is to look forward to, a couple of the creatures you can expect to see included.
I'm so excited.
In this first edition of the Bestiary, we've got the Hippogrifter.
Ooh, Hippogrifter. Nice.
We've got the Contrabanshee. we've got the Graham Reaper. So, and then the last one I'll share with you, because we gotta keep some secrets. There is going to be a Valkyrie. And by Curry, I mean Tim Curry.
Oh!
Yeah, so.
Oh, I don't think I can handle that one. That's too brilliant.
So, prepare yourself. It's gonna be craze.
Mr. Awful McPherson notes that he's from a culture and language that up to less than 5 years ago didn't use puns. And so they're weird to my brain. That is so interesting.
That is interesting.
That is so interesting. Okay. Mr. Awful McPherson, this is for you, but also for everybody. What I think is so amazing, I think it's so valuable to learn another language, even a little bit, because there are things that don't exist in your language that exist in other languages, and you don't know it until you learn someone else's language. And like to think like, oh, you have a concept, and we don't have that concept. Right, like you learn something really interesting the minute you get that, which I suppose you can sort of take into your RPing, right? Thinking about, can you try to get a kind of concepts that work differently? Oh, Mr. McAwful Person's place, Awful McPherson's language does not have any gendered pronouns.
Interesting.
That is so cool.
I may have missed this. Mr. Awful McPherson, from whence do you hail? Where are you from? I'm curious about this. But yeah, so it's, well, and the thing too, the one thing I do want to, point out too, one of the puns I do.
Estonian. He's from Estonia.
Interesting. I know nothing about that, but now I do. Now I know one thing about Estonia.
That's so cool.
No, that's very interesting. Speaking of the language thing, one of my pun creatures is actually a Korean pun that I made up myself, which I'm going to assume works because it sounds like it works. It works to me.
Which is fine.
But it's actually, it's, so little lesson for the gang. So a kumiho is a, it's basically like a kitsune, if anyone's familiar with that. It's the multi-tailed fox spirit of Japan. The Korean version is called a kumiho, and a Korean tiger is called a horangi. So the creature is a kumihorangi. And so that's how I did. And then in there, I'm actually going to have the Korean thing, the Korean words broken down and being like, yo, this is why it's a pun.
Oh.
It's clever. You get it. It's funny. So
I'm going to ask you, just because, have you played Hate?
Every day of my life. No.
No, it's so there's Ludge, there's Love. So Christine Love has done these visual novels, and she did Hate, an analog. What's the title now? The whole game? Oh, hold on now. It's really interesting, but I'm going to have to give you, because there's also Hate Plus, but I'm going to give you the actual title because I don't want to get it wrong. Christine Love, Hate. It's called I'm sorry, it's called Analog, A Hate Story. Thank you. Thank you, Krellen.
I have not. It sounds very familiar to me.
So it is a game. You might find it really fascinating. It's a game set in the future.
Okay.
And you are, I don't know, like a spacefaring person who is sent. A ship has been found. And your job is to go there and download all their logs to find out what happened to this ship. And it is a generation ship. Like one of the, it's like a lost generation ship that was sort of sent off to, like, with all these people that would live on the ship for generations to sort of repopulate a new place. And it was this sort of famous ship that like went missing, was now found, and you're supposed to go and find out what happened to this generation ship.
Oh, interesting.
And basically what it's about, like, it's set in the future, blah, 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 blah. But what it's about is, I cannot remember the time, but it was about how there was a moment in Korean history in the past where women had a lot of agency and autonomy and can do lots of things. And mm-hmm. then something happened and it just all, like, went away. Like,
oh, sad.
Like, Confucianism came in. There was, like, a sort of, like, a...
Yeah, yeah.
A governmental shift, and Confucianism was used to sort of basically oppress a lot of women in these really intense ways. Mm-hmm. And it's this, it's that story of that history, but set in the future. So you are going through these logs, and it's like an epistolary sort of game. Ooh, Mrs. Sal, Sal's wife says hello to everyone. Hello.
Hello.
And it's about, like, and what you do in the game is it's a visual novel, but you're going through basically people's computer logs, right? So you're reading.
Oh, interesting, yeah.
Like, the logs of this person, and, like, you're getting some logs, but not all of them, because, like, some things are like, deleted, and you have a, are corrupted, and you have an AI who's helping you, and there are actually two AIs who are quite different, and you're trying to piece through, like, what happened to cause the collapse of this ship and society and what was going on. And it's really intense. It's a very intense game, but it's very good.
Very interesting.
Yeah. It's about Korean history, but, like, sort of ported into a sci-fi future.
Interesting. No, I'll have to check that out for sure.
It's really
I'm always trying to pick up, especially on, like, Korean based, just for no reason.
No reason. You know, it's so funny. I was thinking about, representation, right? And
go on.
And Asia, which is, you know, a large place.
It is.
There's a lot of stuff in there. And I was thinking about how in the US a lot of Asian representation is not particularly specific and is not particularly diverse, right? So we get, I suppose we get China through Hong Kong, right? And we get Japan. But there's Korea, there's Pakistan, there's India, there's Cambodia, there's Laos. Like, there's a lot. Like, it's a whole entire continent. there's parts of Russia, right? There, like, there's a whole, like, parts of Siberia. There's, like, a whole, it's a really...
Asia, actually, as it turns out, is much larger than Europe.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be the nitpicky one here, but.
Right. And as Krellen points out, Asia's a big place, but most Americans understand that. Whereas Africa is also a big place, and Americans don't comprehend that at all. Yeah, wow. China alone is massive, right? And it has these huge regional differences that are totally different. Mm-hmm. And Sal says we get that Stern Samurai guy, and that's it. And it's funny, like, and I get some of that because I grew up in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, it is very clear that Cantonese is not the same as Mandarin. Like, there are those differences. But a lot of things, and I just was thinking about, like, I would like more specificity. Like, that's what I want. Mm-hmm. I want specificity. Like, I want... Okay. I grew up in San Francisco, as you know. And that made me very privileged, right? Like, there's a certain privilege you gain...
Sure.
When you grew up in San Francisco, and not just San Francisco, but many places, right? So, like, I knew the difference between Sichuan food and Cantonese food. I knew the difference between Vietnamese food and Korean food because I grew up in a place where you could get those things. But there are a lot of places where you'll never get that and where it's all just the same Asian food restaurant or Chinese food restaurant. And you're like, what is Bombay Goreng doing in this Chinese restaurant? And, like, so I just recognize that I grew up with a kind of a privilege to sort of be able to see specificity. But I think that one of the ways that you don't be creepy, like when people ask, well, how am I not creepy? How can I not be creepy? Well, actually recognize specificity, right? Don't be like, oh, I'm going to do an Asian game. And you're like, well, what do you mean by that? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
along that kind of vein, as an anecdote, there was someone telling me about this person that he was on tour with, who one time was saying that, on tour, I had done this too, where you are driving around rural Missouri, giving shows at elementary schools. So the food options tend to be quite limited. He and this gal were driving around at one point, and she says that she wants for dinner some ethnic food.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, you want Italian food? Like, she's like, no, I want ethnic food, you know? And it's just like,
what does that mean?
What is that? Like, what do you want? You know, I mean, that's so offensively unspecific.
Mr. Alpha McPherson just says, I'm from a former Soviet republic, so my first contact with Korean culture was Victor Tsoi, a Russian-Korean frontman of the band Kino. Mr. Alpha McPherson, please note, I am now going to find that band. I want you to know I'm going to find that band, and I'm going to listen to that music, because that sounds amazing. That's all. Like, I want you to know that I'm excited about this band. Rocket introduced me to a band that was so amazing. Where is that music video?
Which one was it? I went through a moment of showing you a whole bunch.
You know, it was the one that was like, that also was a little bit metal, but also was sort of like folk instruments.
Oh, the Korean one?
Yeah. Can you find it and put it in chat, please?
Yes.
Because I want everyone to see this video that Rockette shared with me. It's amazing.
Oh, man. This is, everybody be ready for your brains.
So good. And Mr. Awful McPherson, thank you so much for introducing me to this band. I'm going to look them up. And this is like just up my alley so much. And also, maybe this might make you hungry because some of this food is so good. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Jer, for being on top of that, because yes, that is the way to go. What is this band?
So they're called Narajo. Narajo, I guess, would be the Korean. Make sure it's the one that has the subtitles. Yes. Okay. So it's
so good.
First thing to note, it's a very talented. Why is this? Oh, that's not the right window at all. Hang on. I tried to pop back into the window and it opened Twitter and I was like, what are these ads? What is this? So it's a Korean band. The guitar player has quite possibly the most amazing voice I have ever heard in my life. So prepare yourself for an amazing voice. But it's also kind of, their topics of songs are what some might consider parody material. So yeah, but it's very good. It's very catchy as well.
Oh,
I've heard them.
Yeah, they're good too. I mean, obvious, but I love music. And I love when people interact and engage with each other in really interesting ways. I love that.
Mm-hmm.
And so going back to representation, full circle, right?
Yeah.
You don't want to take people's stuff and be gross, but you can certainly have conversations with people, right? And that's the difference. Are you having a conversation with people? And I think that's the key. Like, you want to be specific, like not just like, oh, I'm doing like Asian whatever, where you're like, I don't, that, what does that mean? But like, be like, actually, I want to sort of like, and then you want to be in conversation. You don't want to just like take things. You want to be in conversation with things. And if you can do that around the gaming table, I think that you can really make something special.
Well, and also because it's like, dude, it's kind of the same thing. Like, if somebody walked up to me and said, hey, are you Asian? I'd be like, no shit. Like, what, you know? Like, but at the same time, you know, it's like, I mean, the whole thing becomes very, you know, the asking of Asian people where they're from, too, is kind of becomes a tiresome activity anyway.
Yeah, and if he says, be curious in a genuine way, and I think that that becomes a question, because the problem with, like, where are you from, mm-hmm. when you're talking about Asian people, I'm sure Awful Person says, do you mean Yemen? Like, what do you mean? Like, what are you talking about? Like, you're talking about, like, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan? Like, where, like, come on, like, where are we going?
Also, this, just as an aside, this always, I just post something, I always want this to be my response to, like,
you'll have to watch that one. That one's amazing. I love it. I love it a lot.
The what kind of Asian?
Yeah. No, I love that. I love that one so much. And it's so good.
Oh, where are you from? Oh, I'm from... No. But before that... England, I guess. double toilet trip.
Oh, Governor.
I love your people's fish and chips.
And I just think the problem is when you're like, where are you really from? Is that it means you don't belong here. Like, that's what that statement really means.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's not a conversation about like, oh, let's talk about your culture. You know, it's a conversation about like, oh, you're a novelty item to me. Like, entertain me with your novelness, you know? No, dude, I don't want to do that.
Yeah. And Levi says it makes them sound like they're visiting. And that thing you like says fish and chips isn't even that good.
Dude, I'll tell you what. I was in London. I went to the Camden Eye, and I ordered fish and chips to do it. And, like, they brought out this thing. The fish was, like, this big. It was this big. It was fine. It was fine. Like, it is incredibly greasy, but it was, like, this big. It was gargantuan. It was crazy.
You know, I like a really good fish and chips, but there are those fish and chips you're like, wow, this is super greasy, and like the chips are like soggy now, and you're like, I don't nobody wants soggy fries.
Although that same day I did walk by World's End. I know. It was very exciting. But
Hrothgar says the comment about you don't really belong here is more relevant today than it's been in a while. And that's the thing you gotta, you know, watch out for. Drummer Boy says asking someone what kind of Asian isn't awkward and slowly moving side to side to figure out which eye is the lazy one if you're talking. Just don't do it. Well, this is interesting. Cyclonus is like, I'm running Legend of the Five Rings, which is Asian, but since the game leans heavily into samurai, I'm just going to lean into it being Japanese, since I have a respect and a relationship with that culture, and I don't want to mess with the other cultures that the game is trying to represent. Yeah.
That's legit.
Yeah.
I mean, my first boyfriend's wife, she is a white gal, and like, they have been to Japan numerous times. Like, she has studied Japanese. Like, she is very fluent. Yep. And here's the thing. At the end of the day, like, she, like, look, I'm not fluent in Japan. I'm not even fluent in Korean. Like, let's be real. You know?
Yep.
like, somebody who's going to respect something.
Yep.
And, well, like, that's fine. But just, you know, just be, I think at the end of the day, just be respectful. Don't just be a butt. Like, can we all just be less of a butt? You know?
Yes. Like, nobody needs to be a butt.
You know, that's all I want. I just want people not to be butts.
And the thing is, I don't think it's that hard, right? Like, I think there's you need a certain humility and an openness. And if he said earlier, a kind of a real genuine curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
And like, do that, like, and listen,
mm-hmm.
and share, right? Like, think about a spirit of sharing. And I think if you do those things, you know, like, that's it. I was also thinking about, this is for me, like, we have to ponder this just like philosophically for a moment, and like, you can tell me what you think. I think there's something fundamentally different about being a GM and a player in this moment.
Mm-hmm.
Because as a GM, you never inherit those characters long term. Like, they come in and out. And I find that GMs can be less creepy because they don't sit in that character for a really long time.
Sure.
Whereas sometimes players can, like, I'm going to be this character. You're like, oh, what are you doing? Like, As Javaya notes that Legend of the Five Rings is kind of bad with the cultures, from what I remember, mixing mm-hmm. Chinese and Japanese culture with some others. Most likely for an Asian culture. Yes, you have to be really careful about Orientalism, right?
Which, you know, I mean, is a real, it's very real. Yeah. John Wayne and Genghis Khan. Like, need I say more, you know? One, Corisei? Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Rissa.
And a willingness to genuinely apologize if you put your foot in your mouth. And I think, I think the real key to that, a willingness to genuinely apologize when you put your foot in your mouth. Yeah. Because I feel like, you know, where we are in time, in culture, we are going to make mistakes.
Yeah.
All of us, we are going to say the wrong thing. Yeah. We are going to offend someone. We are going to say that one dumb thing that just like did not, it may not have come from a bad place, but it just popped on out, you know? And like, and it's like, people are going to make mistakes, you know? And also coming from a place, you know, as, you know, and this is not necessarily to Rissa, but like just jumping on the back of what you're saying, but like, the idea that, you know, even as, you know, a person of color or whatever, like knowing that other people are going to say something that's going to come rub me the wrong way, but like being willing to like recognize if it came from a malicious place or if it was just an accident or if they just didn't know better.
Yeah.
You know, and being willing, maybe not in that moment if I'm very, very tired, but being willing to have some of those conversations.
Yeah.
And, you know, because like at the end of the day, you know, people are not going to learn. People are not going to respond. People are not going to become allies, you know, or even just like want to hear what people have to say in general. We're not going to have a community if people are like yelling and like, you know, because like that's not, nobody likes that. It's unpleasant.
Yeah. Carolyn, superhero in Sino, what are the oops and ouch tool? This I want to know. What is this? Tell me about it.
Yes, so this is actually covered in the
Heroines
handbook. Yeah, and she can type it out, so it's there in a written format. And she probably has better access to it. But the basic idea is, like if people are talking, and we utilize it in the gaming structure. Like, so you're she's giving me the go ahead, green light. But basically you're. For the purposes, like if we were talking about the oops and ouch tool for like a tabletop session, there you are, you're doing something, everything's going along well, and then someone says something that is suddenly surprisingly offensive to someone, and then someone says, ouch, you know, which indicates, you know, I must inquire, Carolyn, what flavor?
That is all. What flavor ice cream?
Yes, but... So just a simple way to quickly indicate that, hey, something was said that rubbed me the wrong way, you know? Yeah. And then the idea that that person can then acknowledge that it was a mistake, and then there can be like a dialogue or whatever. Peanut butter foot swirl, what? You know, and the idea that you don't have to necessarily say oops and ouch if that's not for you, but like, you know, the idea of having a tool set in place. And I think this goes back to the idea of using GMing as activism, like deliberately setting up your space as the GM, and at the very beginning saying like, hey, these are some tools we have in place. Here's some structure that should something come up, this is what you do. I mean, like when we first started playing Night Witches with the different colored cards and even having session zero where it was like, okay, what is off limits for everyone?
Yep.
What is, you know, what are people's lines, et cetera? You know, but also having tools moving forward that can be utilized, that everyone knows what they mean during the process as well.
Because I find the thing with that session zero is that you say, like, I'll hear my lines, but sometimes you don't know all of your lines until you get there. And also, let's be really upfront. My lines are not consistent. Like, if I'm in a game with you and I trust you, I am willing for more things to happen than I'm in a game with people that I don't really know well yet. Like, if I don't know people very well, I have stricter lines about things that I want. That, you know what I mean? Like I'm willing for a bit more edgy things if I trust everybody and I know everybody and I know it's a safe space, then I can do a little bit more. But if I don't know stuff yet, then I'm like, we're going to shut that down. But like sometimes maybe I don't realize that in this context, I'm actually, you know what, I don't like how this is happening now. Right. So like, I want that card.
Well, and also like, and sometimes you just don't know for yourself. Like I was invited to do a stage reading exercise that was to train students or like give students this experience and like, you know, sexual harassment, rape kind of scenarios where they follow this person along in their experience. I thought that would be fine for me, you know, and then I agreed to do it. Later on, I read through the scripts, seemed fine. And then I was reading through and I read through out loud for myself, just prepping for the rehearsals and stuff. And I read through out loud. I was like, nope, nope, this is not going to be for me. And I had to get in touch with the director and be like, as it turns out, this is not for me.
Yeah.
You know, so.
And I also think, and this is a thing about, in some ways, like you think about, by the way, there's a whole discussion about peanut butter and Americans.
I know. I'm seeing this.
I'm seeing it too. I'm like, ooh, but this is like, this is our, this is, yeah, it's one of our crops, right? It's a new world crop. But it's also thinking about, so for example, I am actually okay, generally speaking, with certain kind of discriminatory things happening in game if it's part of the game world. Mm-hmm. Unless it's being used as a means to bully people out of game, in which case I'm not okay with it. And so if somebody says, hey, are you okay with like there being some sexist NPCs and I'm playing in a game, I'd be like, okay. Or would you be okay with some racist NPCs? And I was like, sure, that's fine. But but then if I realize what that means to that GM is that actually it's just going to be like nonstop harassment, then I'm no longer okay with it, right? And so...
And also that's... Dude, that's just also gnarly behavior. Like, just don't be, you know, I mean, no one should be using RPG fun time as an excuse to be an asshole. Like,
yeah.
You know, find a different activity if that's really what, you know.
Well, you know, there was an experience that I had that was... if we had Oops and Ouch, because I feel like Oops and Ouch is not the same as X Cards. It's a little bit different. Mm-hmm. And Rissa says bait and switch is no fun in RP. And I was doing a Western. It was like an Old West game. Mm-hmm. And I decided to play a character that was based on my great-grandfather, who was a cowboy, and he had a ranch. And... what ended up happening in the game was that the GM's idea of historical realism involved my character not being able to do anything and being attacked all the time.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, but that's not... That was frustrating because I was shut down. I really couldn't do much. And the problem is that that wasn't necessarily how it really happened. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, people, there were black cowboys, they did exist, they did do things, right? And I think even if we don't talk about race or gender, I think one of my particular kind of pet peeves is when people want to be realistic and gritty, but what that means to them is actually not in any way realistic, right? Like, people...
What?
Like, not everybody died of dysentery. Like, some people died of dysentery, but not everybody did. It shouldn't be 100% die of dysentery rate, because that's not what happened.
Well, obviously, yeah, there's some people who are still around, apparently.
Yeah.
You know, but, like, but I guess that's the thing, too, and especially as a GM, like, if you were going to play a character that is not going to let your other characters play, just even from a logistical standpoint, that is a bad mechanic.
Yeah.
Because then your people can't play, and that's the point of the game.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and Carolyn says, like, I don't want your game to be just a free-for-all misogynistic rant. Like, that's not good, right?
Right.
So I think that there's, I think this is the thing that's actually really interesting for me. I think that we have to be careful about realism, and so often we think that to be realistic, you just have to be miserable, but people also laughed in the past, right? Mm-hmm. Like, people had a good time sometimes, and they had joy, and not everybody died all the time, and people, you know what I mean? And I think that sometimes we confuse grimdark with realism, and grimdark is not actually realistic. Right? Mm-hmm. And I think we have to be really careful about not conflating those things because, you know, like, and if you want to do that, that's also cool, but don't pretend like you're just being realistic, right? I mean, the Old West had Mexicans and black people and Chinese people, all these cowboys, and also there were gay people. Like realistically, that was also happening. And so I just think we have to, Krullin says being shitty is realistic, right? And, like, we just have to, like, recognize that being shitty is not the same thing as realism, right?
Well, and also at the end of the day, dude, what, like, why does it need to be that realistic? It is a game. Like, seriously.
Well,
you are not in the Old West.
Right.
Like, we are not in the Old West.
Yeah.
here, you know, because like our teeth are not falling out of our heads. Like we are living past the ages of 30. Like we are not in the Old West, you know.
And like, also it's not realist. Like I was thinking about realism, right? As a, okay, work with me. Yes.
I'm here.
I have a good friend of mine who's a drama person, right? And this person, she specializes in like theater history, etc. Mm-hmm. And she said this thing was so good. I was like, so fascinating. She said that realism is not actually realism. It's a particular style. And that style mm-hmm. is often not useful for marginalized people, right? That there, realism is often used as a weapon against marginalized people. And marginalized people, when wanting to create art, often will go to other things, like maybe magical realism or melodrama or styles that are, oh, thank you for being here, Super Heroine.
Yeah, thanks
Sino.
So much for coming by.
Thank you. And so this idea that there are these others, that one, realism is actually just a style of drama. It's not mm-hmm. any more or less realistic than other things. And that oftentimes marginalized people have used other styles like melodrama or, what's the thing? Magical realism, of course, but also commedia dell'arte, these other styles to get mm-hmm. to a different kind of reality, right? Or to a different kind of truth. Like basically realism and truth are not the same thing, right? Basically.
Well, and, you know, I hearken back to when we were talking about nostalgia and the idea of like making America great again. Like, yeah, is it any surprise that like people, you know, marginalized communities would be like, why do you want this cowboy campaign to be that realistic? Like what is... You know, like why is this so fun for you? Like why do you want this cowboy thing to be like so realistic? Like really?
Because of course you're not being realistic with everything, right? Like I mean,
yeah, you're literally not, you're not sitting out in Montana like on a rock. Come on, man.
And I think that becomes really interesting. I think that we really have to, because I do like realistic games. Whatever that
sure.
means, but I recognize that that is a construct, right? And I recognize that like, I don't want, for example, I don't particularly want all the PCs to die of infections all the time. Like, mm-hmm. that may be realistic, maybe it's not, but I don't want it. So we're not gonna have that one. Like, mm-hmm. And I think that becomes something that's interesting. Like, I want, like, we're gonna fast forward through some things. I like a little bit more detail, but I don't want all the detail because then it becomes not playable. So like we're always making compromises on what is real and what is not real. And why is it that some people's want, like their idea of real is just to like make it like really like not pleasant for people. Like, and Sal says, but that's what my character would do, right? Like that one, like that's the worst, because I always get so bugged by that. Because a character, if a character is a person, people are complicated. They can do many different things. Why pick the one that's going to make it worse for everybody? Like, you can pick a different one.
Well, and you know, like, I feel like my solution, and I offer this as a gift to you and your viewers. Like, if someone's being that way, like with a game and a realistic context, mm-hmm. like clearly the answer is just to like start going into detail when you have to poop. Like,
yes.
Like if we're getting into the realism of it, like, all right, my character is going to seek out a brush where they can poop now. Oh, I'm digging a hole. And, oh, looking around. Oh, I think this is gonna be a bad one. I've only been eating beans for the past 3 days. Like, if we want realism, like, I mean, just give them realism, you know?
Yes, right? Yes, roll, and if Rithio says, roll for hole digging.
Right, like, you know, ooh, a stick, no, at least get some leaves. Oh no.
Oh, so good. And I just feel like, come on, like, we know that we're not, like, I'm pinching it off now. Like, and this
I, you know, just as an aside, there was this thing going around where this astronaut lady was talking about, like, bathrooming in space. Did you read this?
I did. It was so interesting.
Interesting is a word.
I don't know if I want to be in space.
The main thing I took away from that is that gravity apparently pulls poop away from your body, and if you're in space, you have to do that manually.
That was my main takeaway as well.
I know. I really don't remember much else other than that if you're in space, you have to pull the poop away. And I was like, well, I'm never going to space.
With a special glove, though. They have a special glove.
That doesn't matter to me. Like, I just don't think it's that important.
It sounds like small, medium, and large condoms. We all need the large condoms. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Lies.
I'm glad that people who ask me to run Call of Cthulhu are not interested in realism. And the thing is, I think that when you're going for realism, what you want is a realistic feel. But that's not the same, right? And I think that becomes the important... Like, you have to know that it is an aesthetic, it's a style. It's not real. So... What that means is that you don't have superpowers. Although you can do superpowers with realism, right? Like, that's the thing. Like, I want to do superheroes, but I want it to feel realistic. And you're like, okay, well, so that usually means that, like, I interpret superheroes with realism, for me, to mean things like you're going to probably care about maybe bills a little bit, right? Like, I'm a superhero, but like, oh, I don't know if I can pay my bills. Like, there are like these certain things that like signal realism, like Spider-Man is like a realistic superhero.
Well, and just like there, you abide by the laws of that world.
Yeah.
You know, and like if the laws of that world are, it is like this world, but people have superpowers, then it is this world in which there are bills, but people have superpowers, you know?
Yeah. And so I think it's just like thinking about, like, basically don't use realism to punish players. Like, that's really it. Like, don't do that.
Like, well, and if you're doing that, you need not be GMing. Like, that is not for you.
Mm-hmm. Sal says bills, collateral damage, criminals getting released on technicalities. Like, that would all sort of fit within like realistic superhero campaign that like you could have something really interesting about, because maybe you want that like you really want to explore. Like, for me, it says like I want to explore like the personal side of being a superhero. Like, you know, their personal relationships and those things. Missile Off of a Person says, when I play CFC campaigns as a character, I always play as a person of the era, meaning being Estonian, very anti-German, which then horribly bothers those realism people. For a game, I was not allowed to inside a house with the main party for a CFC game because I played a black character and it just ruined the experience for me. Yeah, like, come on, like, don't do that. Like, don't, like, GMs, come on.
Like, you can display, like, let's say you're playing a game where there is racism. Like, you can demonstrate that the person, people are giving them the side eye. Maybe they can't buy something from the store, so someone else has to do it, But, like, don't make the game unplayable.
That's the thing.
Like, that doesn't make any sense.
And I think it becomes really important that the GM is not using that as an excuse. Do you know what I mean? Like, and I think, like, okay, so there, and oh, sorry. Here's the other thing I want to say about like, well, you know, there was racism in the past, but even in the 1830s, not everyone was racist, right? Like, do not.
Well, that's how things eventually change. Like, you know, it's not like that suddenly cropped up like overnight and then, you know, everyone was just like, oh, wait, hang on. I had a dream where that was a bad idea, you know, like.
And I love Iffy's point, like, if you want to punish your players, maybe that's a different kind of dungeon master.
Where's that game?
And I just think one of the things you have to remember that, like, not everybody was sexist, not everybody was racist, and also people still did things, like, they were still able to function. And, you know, you're playing a game where the players have to do things, so it should be possible for them to do things in the game, right? That's all.
Right. No, and I completely agree. And, like, again, it's, you know, and at the end of the day, like, it's, I feel like, I don't know, maybe this is just because I'm old and bitter, but, you know, it's, I feel like there are the people who want to create a campaign and act in this particular manner don't necessarily want to create inclusive spaces.
That's right.
For their players or for new players, you know? I mean, I feel like at the end of the day, people who want to use GMing as activism or create inclusive spaces are not going to be those people.
Mm-hmm. And this is actually, so Mr. Alphamic Person says, I use bigoted characters when I GM to also find out about my players' conscious and subconscious bigotries, just protect myself and other players from that. Yeah, and I think that you can...
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, and I think that you can actually use, like, I played a character in one of this campaign, and Rissa was in the same campaign with me, where my character was bigoted. And there are a couple of things I did. I said, first off, hey, other players, I'm looking to be bigoted against these things. How are you, like, you know, are these things okay? Mm-hmm. And I also knew that, like, my goal, that, like, I as a player had to make sure that my character, who may be bigoted, would still work with everybody else in the team. And mm-hmm. that, so I was like, okay, so there happened to be nobody, for the most part, that was the target of his bigotry, which was very mm-hmm. convenient. But I also didn't like my character talk about it all the time and go on and on and on about it. He was bigoted against AI. Mm-hmm. He didn't think AI were humans and, you know, that sort of thing. But also, we had a character who was an AI that we didn't know about. It was a secret. Then we found out about it. And, like, I was all ready for my character to be like, oh, no, I didn't realize that you were an AI, but now that you are, maybe I need to go and, like, rethink my bigotry. Like, because, like, as a player, my goal is to play with other players. Like, I'm not, like,
right.
You know what I mean? Like, you have to be always ready to make right. sure that you're going to do that. And it can be really powerful and wonderful, right, to have that story of the person who overcomes and rethinks things, and you can do something really amazing. But the players have to be ready, have to be willing to mm-hmm. change.
Right, right. And, like, and the thing, too, like, look, I mean, I remember you talking about the campaign you played, I think, as a Japanese character mm-hmm. with a gal who was racist against Japanese people.
Yeah, her character,
like,
yeah.
Y'all had to work together, mm-hmm. like, and, like, on occasion she was like, I don't like it, yeah. you know, but you still had to work. I mean, there are ways you can yeah. still play together and just be like, you know, they can just, your character can be like, hey, can you hand me that screwdriver? And they're just like, no, you know, and, you know, and but you still work together, you
right.
know, and at the end of the day, like, you still have to train, you know what I mean? So there are ways you can do it that aren't, that show that there's kind of a, not an enjoyment of each other, but that you aren't totally out there just like making the game impossible.
And Rissa is the GM in that game. And of course, I think people also forget the fact that there is social niceties, right? Like, in the right. beginning, that character was like bigoted, but, like, we have to work together and it's not polite, right? To do, like, certain right. things in public. So, like I knew that that character had a little bit of it, but that character was generally speaking mostly polite and functional because, you know, people have to be polite in public spaces, right? And so there was a right. lot of, it worked out. And the thing is, now our characters have got a really good understanding with each other and, like, have mm-hmm. really bonded because the player understands that she is playing a game with me and I'm playing a game with her and we like each other and we are friends. And so we mm-hmm. make it work. We never use the game as an excuse to do creepy things. And that mm-hmm. that is, like, so important.
Yeah. Yeah, completely agree. Well, and like as Magic Myth Mayhem says, like, at the end of the day, you are playing a game. Like,
yes.
And the thing is, if I'm going to play a game with somebody who's going to make stuff uncomfortable, I'm not playing with you again.
Yeah, that's right.
Like, I'm not doing that, you know?
Yeah. And I think that this is the thing, right? That we're playing a game, and if you cannot, like, no matter what the characters are doing, we need to play with each other. And if you right. cannot do that, then there is a problem, right? And I think mm-hmm. that, and it's so funny, because I think about this idea of activism, is that many people talk about RPGs as a way to learn skills. Mm-hmm. And if RPGs are a way to learn skills, then that means that there's always a moment for activism. Right? Because what are the skills that you learn? Like, you can learn mm-hmm. the skills of working with other people who are different. You can learn compromise. You can learn the skills of trying to understand people and work those things out. And that's, like, great. And I love what Levi says, right? But my sheet says, you wrote your sheet. You're like, yeah. But my yeah, character well, would, like, no. Your character
well, is... Also, at the end of the day, you have control over that. Like, you know, and it's the same thing for me. It's like, at the end of the day, you have control over you. You know, you may be in whatever mood, you may have had whatever experiences, you know, aside from people who experience PTSD and things like
yeah,
this,
that's right.
you know, and legitimate, you know, but at the end of the day, like, you have control over yourself. Like, you can choose not to be a butt.
Don't you be a make, butt.
You can make that choice. Like, you know, and, like, if your character is acting in such a way and you're like, oh, maybe it was a mistake. Just do something different.
Do something different. Mr. Awful McPherson says, education activism is always a conscious presence in my campaigns.
No, that's fantastic.
And it is fantastic. And I think that's really great. And here's the thing I want to say. It's not Some people might say, oh, that sounds like a downer. Like, oh, I don't want it. Like, no, no, no. It's just life, right? Like, it's not a downer at all. It's just like, it's actually kind of exciting.
Well, and I think that leads into what Ify says too, mm-hmm. about you suppose the GM has a larger responsibility to mitigate and manage different personality types. I don't think it's necessarily, the GM is going to have that responsibility regardless. Like, whether or not you're trying to create activism in the space, the GM at the end of the day is the person managing these people.
Yeah.
You know? Like if two people start to get into a screaming match, you know, I mean, even if you're playing a completely vanilla version of D&D, like someone's got to stop that shit.
Yeah.
You know, like.
And it's funny because I was thinking about, because I know there's some people like, oh, but like GM shouldn't have, everyone has the responsibility, right? And sure, everyone has the responsibility to do something, but here's the thing. The bystander effect is real, right? Where something mm-hmm. happens and people maybe don't want to say something. And being the GM means you need to always, like, you cannot let the bystander effect hit you, right? If nobody's going to say something, you have to say something. You know what I mean? Like, and I think for me, like, I think everybody should be able to say something, but the GM, you have to. Like, if nobody else does, you have to. It is your responsibility. Like, because you're taking on that leadership role to say,
right,
I will say something, right?
Well, and also, you're in control of this chaos. Like, be in control of the chaos, yeah. man. Like, mm-hmm. what's going on here? And I did want to point out, too, Zevai? Ooh. Zier.
Zier.
I am so sorry to everyone everywhere. But yeah, saying thanks for the exception mm-hmm. and referencing being bipolar, like, mm-hmm. you know, as someone currently having my own medications, I do not experience bipolar, but I do deal with some other things and I'm having my medication. You know, I mean, I think trying your best is the best you can do, you know, and I think at the end of the day, like, you know, if you are trying your best, that is wonderful. That's awesome. Because so many people are not even, like, not even aware that there is a best that they could be shooting for.
Yeah, know? Yeah. I love this thing that Rissa says right here. Rissa says, activism is, at least in part, learning to see outside of yourself. And RP allows you to explore aspects of human nature that you don't necessarily experience yourself. And that is one of the beautiful things, I think, about RP. That you can spend some time exploring something that is not you, and you can get some empathy. And that is always activism. One moment. And I have no privacy, whoa, I always feel that somebody's watching me. Tell me, is it just a dream? Thank you for the follow. I'm not gonna read your name right out because it seems a little harsh, but thank you for the follow. Yes. So now, here's the thing, Fox.
Rockette.
It is 9:45, and I promise not to keep you too late, and I know you have more drawing to do.
I do.
And so I'm going to call us to the close today for the Gamer Stories. And by the way, first off, chat, I see you, chat. Thank you for all of your chatting with us today. You've been so wonderful.
Yeah. It's has been fun. This makes me want to get on a stream and just like hang out with people and be like, hey, come and talk to me and hang out with me. Cause like this I could do. Like,
yes.
Oh, thank you so much.
And
yeah, no, I totally will. Like I will. This makes me definitely want to get back on and do more. Like I enjoy this. Like, this
game. Excuse me. Come on everybody. I said, now let's play a game. I bet you I can make a rhyme out of anybody's name. The first letter of the name, I treat it like it wasn't there. And then a B or an F or an M will appear. And then I say Bo at a B, then I say the name, then banana, fan, or info. And then I say the name again with an F, very plain. Then a fee, fi, and a mo. And then I say the name again with an M this time, and there isn't any name that I can rhyme. This is gonna be hard. Wild engineer. Wild engineer, wild engineer, bo, wild engineer, banana, fanafo, filed engineer, fee, fi, mo, mild engineer. Wild engineer. Thank you so much for the sub, Wild Engineer. I hope you enjoy your name game. That is amazing. And your singing unicorn is the best. It is the best.
Thank you. It was an impulse buy. I have no regrets.
I honor it. So I want to thank chat for being wonderful and RocketteFox.
Thank you.
I want to thank you for being here for my gamer stories. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been great.
Because I just want to chat with the people about their lives. That's all I want.
Hey, man. I know. I love that. There's one other thing I will share with you before I go.
Yes.
So as you know, I do the storytelling stuff. So there is one other release I'm going to be doing, which is going to be, I'm going to be doing a release of shirts. It's going to be through Bonfire, which is, I'm doing it because you can actually have all of the shirts on there and I do not have to touch them. People can order them on there and they get shipped from on there. Ooh. So it is easier on myself. But essentially I did this design and I'm going to be doing this to fund my, storytelling business in which I'm doing workshops, and going, to hopefully be traveling around to give these workshops, which are essentially to use the methods of storytelling to teach people like self-empowerment and also just how to like connect with each other and all these different things. But if there is a way, do you know, is there a way for me to flip this to a screen share?
Maybe.
I think I can do that on my own here.
Yeah. While you're doing that, will you tell us where there are other outposts for Super Heroines, etc.?
Yes. So if you would like to find out more about Super Heroines, etc., we are online at superheroinesetc.org. We just got the website redone, actually. So Carolyn actually did the work on that. She does a lot of web stuff and she's fantastic. So there's that.
Oh, and people chat who are here, I want you to know that RocketteFox is my first choice to be in the French Resistance campaign. So I just want you to know that when it's going to happen, right, that just so you know that RocketteFox is on my list. So
the list. It is me. I am on the list. Yeah, that's right.
We got the link for it on the chat was placed out, so that was good.
Yes, perfect. Thank you. So you can find us there. We are on Facebook. We have two chapters as it stands. And currently there is a chapter in St. Louis and a chapter in Cincinnati, but there are actually ways to open chapters elsewhere. So if there are people who are interested in that, that is possible. We have a lot of stuff online. Like we have the Heroines Handbook that you can download off the website for this GMing one we were talking about tonight. And there is another one that is about villainesses, which I actually wrote and designed. And there, it's all free. Like you could just, it's a free PDF downloadable. You could just have it. It is for you. It's a gift. The logo that you'll see with the three ladies on it, that was a recent logo development.
Oh, nice.
That I designed.
You do have homework, by the way.
Homework.
And Iffy brought it up. And so you do have homework. You need to let us know in the foxhole whenever you're going to do this stuff so we can put it in our foxhole so that we can like say like you're streaming and so we can all come and make sure that no trolls show up and be there and we can like get your t-shirt. So you have to let us know so we can support you.
I would love that. And the t-shirt design is actually done. I actually just printed. So let me grab that. I will bring it back because I want to show you.
Yes.
Because I'm really excited about this. Give me 1 second.
Well, she's gone, everyone. Thank you for being here. We're on our way down. But remember, you can see me on Thursday tomorrow at 6 Eastern for Night in the Woods, and then I'll be hosting Critical Role afterwards. Friday, 2 p.m. on the Greyhawk channel, where I'll be doing the Ghosts of Saltmarsh. And Saturday at noon Eastern time for Horizon Zero Dawn, the DLC, and RocketteFox. So here's the thing. RocketteFox and I, we're still going to do this French Resistance thing. We had to like do a bit of a break because of the geek space going down, but I'm in talks. And so when it's going to start up is a bit of a question. Probably like I'm hoping to start I'm hoping to start like in the spring, like, you know, December, January. I don't know yet because there are some people that I'm talking to behind the scenes. And so there, let's just note that there are conversations happening.
I'm really excited about that one, by the way. A French accent is one of the few that I can actually do.
So, so we're good. This is the one. Apparently, Magic Myth Mayhem is very excited to see that you like Kingdom Hearts.
It's true. I'm actually still at the pretty beginning phases of it, the game, because I am still wandering around Hyrule, gathering plants.
Plants are great.
Plants are great. But yeah, so I have here the design that is going to be on the t-shirt. As you know, because we've only been talking about it for a few hours now, something that's very important for me is people being able to share their stories, diverse people, diverse stories being told, because I think really that's the only way that we're ever going to overcome the fear of people who are different from ourselves.
Yep.
You know, like that's the whole thing with why representation in media is important. You know, like so long as people aren't seeing stories that are different, those aren't going to become normalized.
Yep.
You know, and that's one of the reasons why the storytelling events that I host here locally are so important to me, you know, just creating a space where people can get up and build that community by mm-hmm. sharing stories. Mm-hmm. So that being said, here is the design.
That's so cool.
Thank you. So this is going to be the shirt. And I'm gonna have it put on to, we're gonna have some tees, we're gonna have some tanks, we're gonna have, a sweatshirt and whatnot. And then everything from this is going to help fund the workshops and such. So try and get my biz out there.
Do you know where the water tastes like wine?
I do not. And also, thank you, everyone.
Right, it's amazing. It's a video game, and it's basically about stories. And you, like, you're a skeleton hobo. You travel around the world, and you collect the country, and you collect these stories from people. It's a very 30s, 40s, 50s, and they just have added a new DLC or new add-on that adds stories of the Chinese Americans in history.
Ooh.
Into it. So like, I think that like there's like cool like working class folks and like miners and strikers, like all sorts of really cool things. It's a very cool game. And a calendar cover for some reason.
I was gonna say, I'm so slow at typing. But I was gonna say, Rosa asked if it's a mug. It's
Ooh.
Not, the first run is just gonna be the shirts because literally I will not have to put my hands on it and I can just post it. And it's going to be probably like a month run, so it'll be a limited opportunity for that. But I would like to get this on, do a bunch of other things as well, because I really like the design. And I think it's, you know, it is something that's just very important to me.
And remember way back when I said that, when people were like, I don't know how I could ever portray a blah, blah, blah. And I was like, have you ever consumed media by the blah, blah, blah? That's
right.
The point about stories mattering. Like, the reason why stories matter is because when I hear a story, like, when I hear a story of somebody who's, right, from, I don't know, rural Appalachia, and they don't have running water, that story teaches me something, and it helps mm-hmm. me understand something, right, who's not me and not my experience. And that's so important because that's how we can come together, right? When we that's what fights defaultism, right? Going back to what you said earlier, mm-hmm. by having more stories. People are loving your design, by the way.
Yay!
So you just have to
this
tell
pleases
us
me. Well, and you know, and the thing is too, and I've said this before as well, just about you know, Asian stories being told, you know, and it's just an example that's I, for reasons, you know, get latched onto. But like, you know, a lot of the thing that you hear from big Hollywood is like, oh, well, you know, we can't have these Asian actors representing these characters because, you know, people won't identify with that. Which my two responses to that are, listen, can I cuss?
Please.
Listen, fucker. Like, I've been identifying with white people, fully white people, my entire life. Like, I'm sure people can manage this fine.
You can manage. And, you can do it.
And also, the second thing is funny. Also, I don't see that argument being put toward Cars or Zootopia. So you're telling me a minority person is harder to identify with than an anthropomorphized vehicle. What exactly are you saying?
Like, what are you saying?
On the bigger picture. Thank you.
And of course, the thing is, people will be able to identify once they hear the stories, right? And once...
Right, and that's, like... Yeah, maybe people need to be able to identify with other people. Maybe that's why all of this is happening right now, is because people can't identify with other people, you know? Like, anyway, it's ridiculous. Yeah. It's crazy.
But that's why stories matter.
That's right.
That's why stories matter.
I'm a throw this table across the room.
So, everyone, if you want more of this, RocketteFox and I are going to be on a panel on GMing as Activism at Geek Girl Con in November. There we go. I just want you to know it.
Yes, please come out and see us. Like, it's going to be great. And I'll try and see, like, I don't know who else is going to be there, but I'll bring my fun camera and see if anyone, maybe I'll see if I can bring a tripod and see if we can just set something up to,
ooh.
It'd be great to have it, you know?
Yeah, and then we can put it somewhere so that people can see it.
Mm-hmm. So, but the anthropomorphized truck speaks with a Texan accent. That's how you know. That's how you know it's realistic.
That it's realistic because, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But where does the truck poop, Trooper? Where does it poop?
I don't know where the truck's. Okay, then it's like, are you changing the oil in your car? Let's talk about that in great detail. And you're like, we're going to spend like a half hour, a 3-hour session talking about you changing the oil in your car.
Is the truck being allowed inside the restaurant? I don't know.
Mr. Awful McPherson asks, will it be streamed in? I don't know, actually.
We probably could. Like, if we had we could probably live stream it via a phone.
I suppose the question, like, I don't know what Geek Girl Con's policy on streaming is.
We can. Like, they're probably, like, we are allowed to. Like, if we can have the stuff to do it.
We should probably talk to Anna Geeks about this.
Okay.
Because she's in Seattle and, like, she knows the things.
No,
right?
That's true.
She probably has equipment. I'm just saying.
No, this is good. That would be way better than what janky thing I was about to come up with.
We're like, it's a tape.
Because it was about to not be good.
We're going to work it out. All right, but I'm going to let you go because you have to draw tonight.
I do. Thank you so much for having me. This was a blast, and I would most certainly love to repeat it. This gets my butt. Like, I'm gonna get my streaming game back on, and even, like, doing a drawing thing or something just to get me on so that I'll
and then we will support you
from there. Thank you.
And that's it. We'll support you.
Thanks. Oh, my goodness. Y'all make a girl blush.
Like a Texan truck. A truck with a Texas accent. Just...
You're gonna make me blush like a Texas truck.
And as Crit says, we like to hear what the fox says.
Yes!
Or however that song goes.
Yes.
So, all right, we are going. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you, RocketteFox, for being here. And I will catch you all on the flip side, everyone. Take care.
Have a good night.
Good night, everybody.